So it starts, for me, my consciousness hacking experience started when I was in seventh grade, and I was in the courtyard of my school in France, in a small suburb of Paris, and this thought came to my mind, what am I going to do with my life? And then I thought, well, I need to understand why I'm here. What is this thought coming to my, you know, my mind? Where's this coming from? So this started my path, and of course, in my cultural background, that meant, that didn't mean like going in the caves to meditate, that meant, okay, you need to be a brain scientist to see how the brain works. So that's what I did, and initially, I thought, well, you know, most of the brain studies, they work on brain computation. So that was my PhD I did on brain computation. And now, if you talk to most of the neuroscientists, they say, well, consciousness, you have this neural network, and they just interact with each other, and somehow consciousness emerge. And that's still the main explanation these days. So that's what we did. So for instance, this is a movie where we showed some photographs on neural network. We have a retina layer, so we have neurons in the retina. We have orientation layer, so neurons that recognize different orientations. We have neurons that recognize mouth and eyes, and we have neurons that recognize faces. So this is called a connectionist neural network. The biggest I simulated was 30 million neurons and 245 billion connections. And to teach these networks, we had different strategies. One of them was to, for instance, we took some random images, and then we just send them to the network. And then they just learn automatically. So for instance, this one, this neuron, they learn the different orientation automatically. And they learn different ones because they inhibit each other. So this is called the receptive field of the neuron. So this is the kind of pattern they learn to recognize. So this is work that I did. And then in my lab afterwards, somebody took over. And based on the same principle, we show different images, same kind of connectionist neural network. And when you show enough images, I'm going to continue to play here. What appears is that some neurons learn to recognize bikes, some neurons learn to recognize faces close up, and some neurons learn to recognize our faces. And the neural network knows nothing about that. So this is serious brain hacking. But it's not really consciousness hacking yet. So this is like emergence of recognition of objects from basically nothing. Just the neural network knows nothing. You just show it enough images, and then it appears that it learns to recognize images. So after I realized, well, this is just brain computation. What about consciousness? Well, consciousness, what do we know about consciousness? Well, William James says, consciousness is in constant change. Now we're seeing, now hearing, now reasoning, now willing, now recollecting, now expecting, now loving, now hating. In 100 other ways, we know our minds to be alternatively engaged. That's William James. And then, interestingly, we have very similar statement from Buddhist scholar that says, there is no self that stands at the mentality to which characteristics and events accrue and from which they fall away, leaving it intact at death. The stream of consciousness flowing through many lives is as changing as the stream of water. So that's what I really want to study. So I set my path to study that instead of brain computation. And so for instance, this is like the stream of consciousness for somebody that's meditating on some kind of bench right there. And he's just thinking about his belt. Did I remember to loosen my belt? It's definitely getting tighter. So it's all these thoughts that crosses his mind. And we call this mind wandering. So one of my main interests when I started meditation, I was doing a lot of mind wandering. I was always thinking about something else. And I wanted to understand why, and you'll see that a lot of some of my research is geared toward building machine that can try to help you to meditate in some way. But basically, what is mind wandering? So to test that, one of the experiments we did, it's not with EEG, it's with NIRS, functional near infrared spectroscopy. And then you see, you have this headband right there you put on the forehead, which collect data from this location, of course, through the skin. And then we had this task. I'm not gonna enter the detail of this task. Basically, it's a very boring task. So the participants, they tend to think about something else. And so what happens when they think about something else? What we saw, and we can see it in this movie. So this is when there is a stimulus, and this is the trials in which they think about something else, and this is the trials in which they are concentrated on the task. And what we saw is that we saw some strong difference when they were mind wandering compared to concentration. Now the goal here, and we've done that with NIRS, we've done that with EEG, we've done that also with the pupil size, we've tried to use whatever we could do to do that, is to do some classification of mind wandering. So this is machine learning. You want to use machine learning technique to find out if this person is mind wandering or not. And it's possible. The problem is the accuracy is relatively low. I mean, the accuracy is about 56%. You would want like about 95%. You don't want like the machine to always make a mistake. And so that's been in my research. We've done that with EEG. We've done that with pupil size as well. We can go up to 75%, but right now we're like capped at 75%. Now, another interesting thing with mind wandering is, as I mentioned, it's like occurring during meditation a lot. So like you have some of the meditators, meditation is too hard, and this one is dinner. Neither of them is really meditating. They just have different thoughts in their mind. But what's interesting is to study meditation during mind wandering, because the subject is not doing anything. So to do this, I headed to India. So there's actually an ashram in Rishikesh, and they bought a very expensive piece of EEG equipment, and they didn't know what to do with it. So we went there and collected data on more than 150 participants in this ashram that's here inside the ashram. So that's the EEG system, 64 channels. And one of our paradigm is we just ask people, okay, you're gonna count your breath. So that's a basic meditation practice. Count your breath up to 10. And then whenever you lose the count, you press a button. So here this starts, you know, person starts thinking about work, and then she realizes, oh, I'm not counting anymore. And then she presses the button. If you go after 10, more than 10, you press the button. If you have to think hard about what's the next number, you press the button, basically. And then so we had EEG on them. This is the tools we use to analyze the data. That's the software I've developed called EEG Lab. There was a survey that showed that's the most used software. It's free, so obviously it's more used than the commercial ones. And this is some of the tools I'm also going to show you that we use to study brain dynamics. And then what we do is that we get data from our participants. So that's the raw EEG data. Then we get the scalp topographies here. And the scalp topography, basically when it's red, means high amplitude brainwaves. When it's green, it means low amplitude brainwave. And when it's like yellow, it means intermediate amplitude. And then we can also project that onto the actual head of the subject. Here, this is a system with 256 channel. And we can also do some source localization inside the brain. So that's what we found for the experiment I just talked about. So they press a button whenever they lose track of the counting. And we define, okay, like before they press the button, mind wandering, That's they were mind wandering, and after they press the button, they just focus again on the task. And this, so that's the focusing period, and that's the mind wandering period. And what we saw, that's called a spectrogram right there. So it just represents the amplitude of different frequencies. So you have theta, alpha, beta. And what we saw is that we saw a strong decrease in theta, for instance, and an increase in alpha. So when they're focusing, we have different brain activity when they're mind wandering. And believe it or not, this study is, to my knowledge, the first EEG study that used pure introspection. Basically, we just ask the subject, okay, you close your eyes, you count internally, and then you just press a button. From the outside, you just see the person pressing the button sometime. So this is pure introspection. We don't use any stimulus outside. We just ask people, just what's going on in, what's your introspection? What's your own evaluation of your mental state? So to my knowledge, that's the first experience that did that. And the reason it's the first is that it's very hard to do. When we had participants come, we had one come and he freaked out in the middle. He was a naive meditator. He freaked out in the middle of the session and he had to stop because he wasn't used to sensory deprivation. That's like something hard to do for most people. They can't just sit and count their breath. We had somebody who was a meditator. He pressed the button once, and we need at least them to press at least 20 times. Yeah, I think I have to start the quick time. I forgot to start the quick time. Right, okay. And most participants, we recorded them for more than an hour. So that's kind of unusual. Most people, they come and go. You test people for 20 minutes. And also what we did is that during this experiment is that we had sounds playing in the background, so they're just instructed to ignore the sounds. But for instance, that's one of the sound. Is this working? Oops. It's not working. Okay. Doesn't matter. So one of the sound is beep, and one of the sound is boop. So basically, we just ask them, you do your counting, there's some beeps and boops, you just ignore it. But what we can see is that we can see the responsiveness of the brain when they're in the mind-wandering state, the non-focused meditation state, compared to the concentration, the meditation concentration state. And what we saw is that we saw when they were in the mind-wandering state, the brain tended to respond less. And that's the scalp topography that's associated with that, than when they were focusing on their breath. So this is an indication. The interpretation of this was that, okay, they're mind wandering, their brain is kind of more resting in some sense. It's less sensitive to external stimuli. And that's very interesting from a perspective, neuroscientific perspective, because we want to know what's happening in these states. Now, in this same task, that's not exactly the same data, but that's just historical of what we can do with the data. These are four different versions of what we call brain movies. So we try to figure out what happens in the brain using the little information we have at the scalp level. And this is what we were doing in 2002, in which you have brain areas which we localized here, and we have some dynamic going on, like, so this is the presentation of the sound, for instance, and this is the dynamic that's associated with this. This is what's happening in 2002, and then we got a little bit better, 2004. Now we can put them in 3D in the brain, and we project on different slices of the MRI. And again, that's the same task I showed you before, so we can look in more details what's happening in the brain. Now this is more recently in 2012, in which now we can see the skin, we can see the bone, the cortex, and now we have all the brain areas activated. And this last movie I didn't generate, but one of my colleagues actually with which I collaborated on doing this one, work on this last movie. I'm just showing it because it's so beautiful. It's called The Glass Brain. And that's like kind of a state of the art these days, where it shows it's not any more anatomically correct than this. It's just nicer. But basically, that's the kind of tool we try to use to study brain dynamic. So what is special about meditators and mind wandering? So we're about to tease out some activity in the brain associated with mind wandering and meditators. But what is special about meditators? Here we did another experiment, and that's a very simple experiment. I just asked you to meditate, and then every 2 minutes or so, it's random, there's a voice that asks you, okay, what's the depth of your meditation? And you don't open your eyes, you just have a keypad on your leg, and then you just press a number from here it was 1 to 5. We also asked them about the depth of their mind wandering and how tired they were. And we had 24 people. Now what's interesting is that we found, so these are expert meditators, and we found expert meditators, they are very concentrated. So this is the rate of meditation, and this is the rate of mind wandering. And that's very different from novice meditators. Novice meditators, they have the same level of mind wandering and meditation depth. And this is the statistics we do to show that it's different, doesn't matter that much. As weird as it sounds, it's like if you ask somebody that's meditating, well, does meditation affect mind wandering, the monkey mind, they call it in the Buddhist tradition. You say, of course, yeah, you tend to mind wander less when you're meditating. But it's actually hard to study. I had done other experiments before that, before I was able to show that. This is the first study, to my knowledge, that shows that meditation decreases mind wandering. The first one that decreases thoughts. So you tend to have less unrelated thoughts when you're meditating. But again, that's not a definite story, because it could be that the people here who are experts self-selected. So you might have two populations. So you have one population of novices, and then the one who tend to mind wander too much, they just drop out. So you're left with the expert level, you're left with the one who don't mind wander. So it doesn't mean that with meditation, you mind wander less, but it means that if you have experienced meditators, they show less mind wandering. We also, when I arrived in the meditation field in 2002, and it's still the case right now, everybody talks about, oh, I'm doing research on meditation. It's very popular these days. There's actually hundreds of researchers doing on meditation. It has boomed over the past 10 years. But they would call meditation very different things. Like, for instance, you have Vipassana meditation, that's body scan. That's very different than, for instance, transcendental meditation. That's like mantra-based, which is very different from Tibetan meditation, which could be a variety of things, but could be, for instance, visualization of deities or things like that. So these are very different meditations. So to put them all in the same pot just doesn't seem right. So in this experiment, which we did in India, in the ashram I showed you, we had 104 meditators and controls, and we're trying to see, well, what's the difference and what's the commonalities among the meditation practice. And basically what we found is that we found all the meditators tended to have more high range frequency, so we call it gamma frequency, which was consistent with other studies. But this was again, this has just been published. This is again the first, to our knowledge, comprehensive study of different meditation tradition, where we have free meditation tradition and we have controls. And again, this might be related to the fact that we're mind wandering less or not. So this is what we found. So then another focus of my research is to look at meditation and neurofeedback. This is an article we published. This is about 3 years ago. If you Google meditation on neurofeedback, you'll end up on this. That's like, how can we use neurofeedback to improve meditation? And to do that, this is still research in progress. But basically, we took the brain activity we found in meditators, and we just asked naive people, okay, now do the same thing. Just like, we don't ask them meditate, we ask them reproduce the same brainwave. So we put them in a system like this. So we record their brain activity, then it's fed in real time to a screen, and then basically the color of the square depends on, in this case, the power in the theta band in the frontal region. And that's mimicking what we saw in meditators, basically. And we're also looking at structural changes. So we do fMRI scan before and after to see if like the thickness of the cortex changes. This has been shown to happen in meditators. And we have a battery of tests before and after to see, for instance, if they're mind wandering less after neurofeedback training. So our preliminary results show that we have some effect of training. So we had 24 subjects and we had double blind, meaning like you come for the experiment and you're going to do the experiment, but actually maybe you're not going to do the experiment. Maybe it's going to be the brainwave of someone else that are going to be fed in the system. So maybe you're just thinking you're doing the experiment. So half the people think they're doing the experiment. They are not really doing the experiment. They're seeing the same feedback as somebody else, and half the people are actually doing the experiment. And the reason we do that is that it might be that the subject, they come, the participants, they come to the lab and they think, this is so cool, I'm doing neurofeedback. And then you have the placebo effect. They just do better just because they convince themselves they're going to do better. So this is a way of controlling that. We showed that the real neurofeedback did better than the sham neurofeedback in the training. So they did improve in the task and the sham didn't. We haven't analyzed all the data, so I'll report that another time. So again, this is all very mainstream. This is all, like, you have lots of lab doing that in the world. And this is definitely telling us something about consciousness, but is there something else that might be studied about consciousness? And then, so there is this conference in Denver, organized by the Mind and Life Institute. And here I'm going to play a small part where you have here, hopefully the sound's going to be working. You have here Mathieu Ricard, and this is an eminent neuroscientist, Wolfsinger. This is a philosopher. So this was a room full of mainstream scientists, and this is what he said.
I want to just give one example, because when I was discussing with my philosopher father, he was a completely unbeliever, agnostic, anything you want. And he was, one of the first things he took me on was about this really stupid stuff about all what we have been talking about. And so I told him, look, I'll tell you a story, and then you make whatever you want out of it. But what I promise you is I'm not telling you lies. So, one day I was in my hermitage in Darjeeling, living with my teacher, and I used to come to see him every night for many years to, you know, have teachings and so forth. And then one day I remember when I was a teenager, my uncle was in the seaside, and there's a lot of those rats that immigrated from America on ships that were destroying his pond. And he was a hunter, and he told me, why don't you go with a rifle and see if you find some rats? So I basically never hunted and didn't fish much, but somehow for some strange reason, I took that rifle and went there. I was 16 years old. So then one of the rat came, and I shot, and the rat jumped. And I hope still now that it didn't really kill him. It was just a surprise, but I don't know. In any case, when I was doing retreat, I was 20 plus, and then one day that things came very clear in my mind, and I said, how could I ever conceive of doing something like that? I speak of lack of empathy. Not even, but imagine what it would be to be just a nice rat swimming there and someone just tried to kill. So was unbelievable, actually. I could not believe that I had done something like that. And I said, well, I'm going to tell my teacher, sort of kind of confession. So at 5 o'clock, I went down from my hermitage, went to see my teacher. That time I didn't speak Tibetan, but his son was interpreting. And as usual, I sort of bowed down 3 times. And I looked at him and he was laughing at me, just heartily laughing, and telling something to his son. And when I came by, he said, how many animals did you kill in your life? You know, he never ever asked me about my past, my youth, my stories. He knew I was coming, being an ex-scientist who decided to sort of live and receive teaching from him. He never asked me a question about my channel of any kind. And at that very moment, he asked me that. So, and it looks very simple. It was not like suddenly there was some vibes and strange lights in the room. It was just like a nice joke. But just give me an explanation. I don't have one.
So this was, so Mathieu Ricard, who doesn't know Mathieu Ricard? So Mathieu Ricard was the translator to the Dalai Lama. He's like if you name a monk, he's like the most well-known monk in the world, basically. He's written many books. And this was Wolf Singer, who's probably like one of the most known and powerful neuroscientists in Europe. And so, and everybody was stunned at the conference. Everybody was like, oh, why are you talking about these kind of things? And then so after that, Wolf Singer said, well, it's just a bunch of neurons, and then consciousness emerged, basically the first explanation I just gave you. So that's what mainstream scientists has to say about that right now. We conducted a survey at IONS on meditators, so we just asked meditators to answer. There's 1,117 people, so there's like more than 1,000 people answered, and we asked them about their experience during meditation. And these are the answers. For instance, here you see that more than 50% said they had experienced clairvoyance or telepathy during their meditation. Doesn't mean it's real, it's just that's what people report. More than 50% said, I've experienced that during my meditation. Experienced non-physical entities or a connection with my guru or teacher. So it's not something that's rare. That, again, it could be they're deluded. Could be like where they just think they are experiencing that, but it's not real. So is it real? And so that's why I was interested in looking at, because from the perspective of consciousness, basically, is there such thing as non-local consciousness or not? And to study that, I looked specifically at mediumship. So that's people you come and they give you reading and why did I look at, they give you a reading about a deceased relative. And why did I choose that? First, it's the only paranormal job. It's in the Bible, you have things about mediums. It's like ancestral and very relatively easy to find. In comparison to psychics or people who are predicting the future, very easy to test. You do it in a blind fashion, which we do. And you just tell them, you give them a name they know nothing about and ask them information about that, and then you go check it out. Is it real? Is it true or not? So they're easy to check. It usually involves extreme emotions. And if you look at when people report experience of telepathy or out of body, being able to see things, it's usually in circumstances of life and death. Also, there were two papers published before. I don't know if you heard about the Veritas project that was run about a decade ago. And finally, so this so it's again, it's easy to test. So that's this is a website I design in which your task, if you accept it, you can go on it right now if you want. It's called intuitiontest.org. So you press start, intuition tester. Gives you what to tell you what to do. You're going to see images. How you enter your name, whether you're male, you know, your intuition, etc., if you've been working as a medium. And you're going to see pictures. Half of the people are deceased and half of the people are still alive. So it's loading images. And your task is to say, well, I think this one is alive and I think this one is deceased. So this one, for instance, probably living, uncertain, probably deceased, etc. So you got 200 of these pictures. And the reason we put so many is that in all science, we believe in statistics. So you got to have powerful statistics. So you got to do a lot of numbers. So that's why we put 200 pictures. So that's, here we're getting to the end, 199, 200, okay, and then you get your score. What's your score? By chance, you should have done 50%. You're performing slightly above average. You did 51.3%. So this site is still online. The origin of our task is that we normalized the picture. So we took the original picture. Most of the picture were from classroom pictures from the 1960s. So just portraits. So half of the people, because it's the 1960s and they were about 18, 20 years old at that time, but now half of them have passed and half of them are still alive. And so we select the ears, the nose, so we can recenter the image. We resample, so all the images have the same number of pixels. They're all in gray level. The gray level is normalized, so they all have the same amount of luminance. Same amount of contrast. Then we put them through another software I designed where you say, oh, that's a male, that's approximate age. He's looking right at the camera, he's not wearing glasses, he's facing the camera, not smiling, etc. What's the resolution of the picture? And then we have a bunch of volunteer motivated because there's like several hundreds of pictures that rate all of these image. And then we have heuristic. We have a computer program that's basically going to generate 100 pictures of people who are alive and 100 pictures of people who are deceased. And all the pictures will be having same number, approximately same number of people who look straight at the camera, approximately same number of female, male, etc. So they're balanced database. Because we don't want, like, for instance, all the alive people are smiling, all the dead people are not smiling. That would be a problem. This is preliminary results we got online. And this is our participants. It's slightly above chance. This is what we call a robot. So we built a robot that basically goes online and click randomly just to check that there is nothing wrong with our program. It doesn't really do that. It's another clients, etc. And so this was promising. Then we tested two professional mediums in the lab. And now we up our number of pictures online. We have 200. Here we have 404. And again, they do the same thing. We record their brainwaves. This is what we got. So chance is 50%. And you can see that most of our medium are above the 50%. Level. They could be equally down under. There's no reason why they should be above at all. And then when you have a little star, it means like this specific subject was independently significant. Two mediums were at 49%, so they did worse than chance. But globally, this was what we call very significant. So it's unlikely this is due by chance. And again, it's just one experiment. It has to be replicated. Doesn't mean it's necessarily real. It could be over bias. For instance, it could very well be that even though the pictures are old, something in the picture we're telling you this guy lifespan is going to be shorter than this other guy lifespan. So you could base your decision on that, even if it's unconscious. Then we look at the brainwave data. So basically, we have two types of pictures. We have the pictures of alive individuals, and we have the pictures of a deceased individual. And then we slice the data. So basically, we take a slice around this, the alive ones, we take a slice around the deceased ones, and we build an average. That's represented here, so that would be the average for the alive and the average for the deceased. This is how their brainwave looks like. So it looks like regular brainwave, which is promising. And this is, it doesn't show anything specific, it just shows your brainwave is normal. It's good. Now we look at what's the difference between the deceased and the alive pictures, which are correct and incorrect. And what we found is that we found a region here, very early, there would be more unconscious processing, where we have a difference between the deceased pictures which are correct and the deceased pictures which are incorrect, because they did a lot of error as well. For the alive picture, we didn't see any difference. And then we localized that in the parietal region here. So again, this could just be occurring by chance. It's not because you use the most robust statistics that it's necessarily real. This would have to be replicated to really show that there is an effect. Usually you want a replication by another lab. This way, if there is a bias in the program, this is removed. So that's basically so what I'm working on right now, more like the further reach of consciousness research, like is there such thing as global consciousness that this medium could have access to? I won't make any hypothesis whether these spirits are alive and they're talking to spirits. For me, it's the same thing. It's just an anomaly in the standard model, trying to see if it's real, and then we'll interpret it. So are we there yet? Not yet, but it's more open than it used to be. Like meditation research, for instance, when I started in the 1990s, was like a taboo. You were like talking about consciousness research. It was just like you wanted to ruin your career, and now it's like mainstream. Everybody wants to do meditation research, so maybe one day everybody will want to do psi research and mediumship research. Who knows? So thank you to most of the experiments were run by my students, and I also have lots of collaborators. And thank you to you for your attention. And also, all the mediumship, all these experiments, they're obviously not funded by the National Institute of Health or any federal agency. So we welcome donation, or you can join IONS.
You mentioned IONS National Annual Conference coming up.
Yeah, the annual conference of IONS is coming up in July in Oakland.
Wow.
Noetic.org is a big gathering of many of the consciousness researchers from around the planet in Oakland in June, July?
July, early July.
So, do you have any questions?
Yeah. On the dead or alive test, how long does it go and how do you count for people who may have died during the test?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. So, we tested just before the experiment. And it seems our database, nobody had died, but also our source of information is unreliable. We can't be 100% sure. It's not like we're in contact with the family of every single picture, etc. So now I'm running another experiment. We're not going to test the cause of death. We're not going to test whether they're alive or deceased. And the reason we did this experiment, by the way, is because one of the medium we tested in a previous experiment, we did several tests on mediums. I only had time to present one here. She said, people bring me a picture and then from the army or something, because that's the only picture they have of your grandfather. And then the medium says, but I can feel everybody in the picture, how this person died, etc. So that's why we tested them with pictures. The experiments we're doing right now to address one of these points, like for instance, we can't continue to use the same database of image because people, pass, and then so our database becomes invalid. We're going to use a database of pictures where everybody is passed, but using different ways. This guy was killed, homicide. This guy died in an accident. and this guy died of cancer, etc. So we have categories of people that passed in different ways, and now we're going to ask the medium, now tell me how this person passed. And this is going to be better controlled in some way.
For the next questions, would you mind repeating?
Okay.
Hi. I'm really curious about the research you did around different types of meditation and how that affected people's ability to concentrate. I know you said that all the forms of meditation that you looked at seemed to have a positive correlation with concentration, but did you notice any statistical significance between any particular types above any other types? And also particularly around like Vedic types of meditation where it's really not about trying to concentrate really hard on anything. It is about allowing your mind to be free but not trying to regulate it. I'm curious how those types of meditations might affect the right meditation.
Yeah, so in our experience where we compared meditation tradition, we had the two main types. I mean, if you look like researcher on meditation, they divide the spectrum of meditation around two main axes, concentration versus open awareness. So either you think you're concentrating your mantra or your visualization very hard, and that's what you have to maintain in your mind, and whenever you mind wandering, you suppress mind wandering. Or open awareness, you just welcome whatever is here. If you're mind wandering, that's fine as long as you're aware of it, so you can just observe the mind wandering. And so we had both types. We didn't test specifically, okay, are these guys mind wandering more than these guys or not? And first, this was a difference experiment. Second, when you bring meditators, they don't want to be tested against each other. That's one thing. Like, for instance, we had a groups of transcendental meditation we were trying to test, and basically meditators don't want to be tested against another population. And then also I believe it depends on the person. I mean, like for instance, like if you choose Zen, you might be more intellectual. Than, you know, if you choose a tradition that's more like devotion. Because it talks to you more, like Zen is emptying your mind and you think all the time and you're very good at thinking, so because of the, you choose that one, you might mind wander less or more based on your personality. So, you know, if you orient yourself to one tradition, doesn't mean necessarily, oh, this tradition tends to lead you to mind wander less or not. It might be just self-selection of that specific tradition. We didn't look because we didn't run the experiment in the same way.
But the Vipassana green line did something different than
yes, the Vipassana had more alpha brainwaves. What does it mean? Well, you can read the paper, there's many interpretations. Why?
There's more. It's a good segue. We got a couple questions from the live stream. And essentially they're asking, can you discuss the specific sensing technology, how that's different from other means of sensing, the specific interpretation technology, you know, MATLAB, etc., and also what is being measured? Is alpha, beta, or in the mind wandering discussion, what are you measuring, or is it a ratio of signals? Someone's really asking, kind of.
Yeah, how are we processing the data?
Yeah.
Well, it's basically signal processing. So if you do electronics, you have your signal. That's like a time series. And the same thing for brainwave. It's a time series. So you used to use the same tools, use Fourier analysis to look at the different frequencies. So it's basically the same kind of tools. Now, if we do ratio, so there's two types of. This would be a long answer, but basically there's been two types of trends in the EEG community over the past 30 years. There's the trend that's like, and that started with the event-related potential. The first time they did experiments, their computers were not very powerful, they could only do average, and now they saw, oh, there's something in the brain, and then they didn't really care anymore what's going on in the brain. They're like, I see something. Before I had reaction time as a measure of behavior, now I just look at the peak on my graph and that's my measure. And that's all I use. I use the latency of my peak, and I do this experiment, I do this experiment, I do this other experiment to change the latency of the peak. They don't understand at all what's going on in the brain, and the truth is they don't care as much. They just want to show an indicator of something different. The types of experiments I'm doing are more like, okay, what can we infer from the brainwave about what's going on in the brain, like the brain movie I showed you. So it looks nice, but it's very hard to do, and also it's very hard to validate because you only have signal at the scalp sensor, and you're trying to find out what's going on in the brain, and there is not a single solution, mathematical solution to that. There is many solutions. So then you have to put constraints on your model, etc. So it's much more involved than just looking at a marker. So like, for instance, if you look at a ratio of frequency, it would be like more finding a marker. So it's same thing. We look at the raw signal, so it would be like, you know, raw theta, and then we don't even call it theta, because my theta is not going to be the same as your theta. My theta might have a peak at 5 hertz, your theta might have a peak at 6 hertz or something. We tested a very advanced meditator, Swami Veda. He had his alpha peak that's usually 10 hertz, he had it at 7 hertz. So that's why it's important to look at the whole signal, and I don't know if that answers the question.
Just to start off, other beings from the audience, dealer's choice.
From what you have showed us and what you have tried to show us, what are you learning and how is that leading to your research to develop?
Yeah, I mean, my goal is to, I'm too lazy to meditate all the time. And I'm a neuroscientist, and basically my rational mind needs to be convinced. And so I do that research mostly I don't only do it for myself, but I also do it for myself. Why? Because if I can convince my rational mind, okay, using all the tools of science and the best statistics you know, and by the way, when I start looking at mediumship, I really up a notch in terms of statistics because people attack you on your statistics. So I had to learn much more statistics than I, but I want to know, is it real or not? Because if it's real, it means, okay, there's a global consciousness. And then for my personal development, it's like I believe it might be a switch in my mind, but my rational mind won't shut up in some sense. So that's part of my spiritual practice, is my work in science, where I can show, okay, global consciousness exists. From, you know, if science is just a method. So you just use the method, you just use the recipe the best you can, and then you just show whether it's real or not. And nature doesn't care, you know, if telepathy exists or not. Yeah?
You had an earlier slide where you showed the 3 or 4 different types of meditation and the control. But around mid-40s, both spiked.
Yeah.
And I was wondering what, if you...
That was at 50 hertz, it's the line noise. So basically, it's just the electricity in the building. It was in India, we had a lot of electricity. Over there, they light up light bulbs. We just put one wire in the ground. And so we actually spent lots of our time in India. It was spent to just ground the building that was recording the EEG data. We had a guy that just came to make a big hole so we can put the ground very deep and ground the room because the electrical noise was everywhere.
All right, last question
for you.
Yeah.
Oh, awesome. Cool. So I work a lot in brain stimulation with ultrasound, and I have some people over at New Mexico that are doing some ultrasound stimulation for meditators, and I'm trying to bring a lot more people on involved in that project. I'm kind of working with DARPA and stuff. So, would you be open to exploring some meditation and ultrasound brain stimulation in the future?
Sure. I mean, I know at Harvard they have this, so they use that for cancer, right? So to burn out the tumor.
Yeah, there's ablation, which is high intensity, but really low intensity actually can, we've shown with fMRI data that you can actually really change the connectome of the brain. It's really interesting.
Yeah, that's super technology.
Yeah.
I'm not 100% sure I want to do it on myself because it's like, but it's like, it's like it's. Yeah, well, but you know,
Sterling is doing fun work. If you want to be a guinea pig for this stuff, absolutely talk to Sterling. We're having breakout sessions where maybe we can get into that further. Does anyone have a quick burning question, like bonus one, right there?
So, the medium.
Yeah, that's exactly what we're doing. It's exactly what we're doing to. Yeah, so the question was, well, can you just use machine learning technique basically to try to find what type of image is presented? Because even if we balance them, you know, maybe the computer would be able to find some small differences that, you know, the eyes can't see, etc. And so basically the answer is yes, that's what we're doing. We're doing that to see, you know, can the computer detect the same difference or not.
Okay, let's get a round of applause.